If you have a smart speaker, you have access to the entire world of NPR and St. Louis Public Radio. All the latest news and all the captivating stories. Activate our voices with yours by telling your smart speaker to play St. Louis Public Radio.
Maria Chappelle-Nadal returned to the Missouri House after an 8-year stint in the Missouri Senate. And the University City Democrat is engaged in the debate over a city-county merger and a new state legislative redistricting system. Chappelle-Nadal joins us on the latest edition of Politically Speaking, so let's hit the music.
This is Politically Speaking, the longest-running episodic podcast about Missouri politics.
It's a little complicated in Bolivar because there is a Parsons family there.
But we also knew that it was important to make sure that we got to where we needed to go.
You know, if you walk in a room and you're getting ready to make a decision and everybody in the room looks like you, you need to stop.
And right now what happens in the United States Senate is as critical as anywhere else in the country.
I really want the state to succeed.
Well, we want everybody to know that we're all working together.
I just worked hard to try to build my name where I didn't have the money.
And welcome to Politically Speaking. I'm your host, St. Louis Public Radio's political correspondent, Jason Rosenbaum, joining us for the fifth time. You're joining the Five Timers Club of the Politically Speaking podcast. Our guest today is
Maria Chappelle-Nadal.
And we've had this conversation tongue-in-cheek. You are a state representative now, but I think that since you were a state senator, people should call you state senator because that's the higher title. Is that fair to say?
It is fair, but I also accept Maria. I accept representative. I do not hide away from any position that I've held.
Yes. So we're going to be talking about a lot of current events, including the one that happened today as we're recording it. It is Friday, about 2 p.m., and former St. Louis County Executive Steve Stenger has pled guilty to federal corruption charges. He is facing, based off the federal sentencing guidelines that Rachel Lipman and I looked at, 3 to 4 years in prison, possibly more, possibly less. And it marks probably one of the most dramatic and consequential weeks in the history of St. Louis County politics. Maybe Buzz Westfall's death rivals it, but I think it's up. It has to be in the top two. What do you make of this past week?
Well, I have to tell you that I am a huge fan of St. Louis County's past, and I've looked at the previous county supervisors, as they were known, starting with Larry Roos, through Gene McNary, and obviously Buzz Westfall and Charlie Dooley. And the good thing about St. Louis County's history is that we have always been service-oriented, especially with all of the municipalities that are or areas that were not incorporated. So we're talking about the unincorporated areas. I remember reading in my research several times where people would say, we need this in this area in the south, or we need this in the north. And it would be up to Larry Roos to actually go down to these areas and talk to people, which he would do to provide those services and needs that people had and would talk about. So to get to this point, to be such a fan of our St. Louis County history, and to get to this point is more than a travesty. It is a hard mark against our history. And I just really hope that in the future we can get back to customer service as we once did in St. Louis County.
This is going to a clip from the new county executive, Sam Page, who we're going to talk about for a bit after this. This was him kind of responding to the actual indictment, which, for in a nutshell, accused Stenger of aggressively steering county contracts to his political donors in exchange for campaign donations. This is what County Executive Page had to say about that.
What surprised me was the apparent comfort of exchanging contributions for decisions. It seemed to be almost mechanized and comfortable. And I don't think very many elected officials would like to see that or be in the middle of that or be near it. And I know that folks that were in county government were very uncomfortable with it. A lot of people left. A lot of people tried to step back from it if they could. But I think the comfort of the way some of that was done was really amazing to me.
I know you're not a you were not a fan of former county executive Stanger. You didn't even endorse him after he won the 2014 primary. You endorsed Rick Stream. You actually ran an ad for Rick Stream. And I know a number of African-American municipal officials, along with Councilwoman Hazel Irby, also did the same thing. With that as a caveat, what do you make of Sam Page's comments about the former county executive's actions?
He was too kind, actually. And, you know, I don't put any fault on Sam at all. I think he's a great person, and he is going to lead St. Louis County with integrity and due diligence, what the people deserve. But I got to tell you, from the very beginning, there were questions, even when Steve Stanger was a council person in the 6th District. His own constituents didn't like him. And in fact, before the general in 2014, we put together several pieces of video of his own constituents saying how he would never call back, how he would never just follow up. And you can see in the indictment, even though he was doing dirty deeds, it was really hard for him to follow up on his dirty deeds because he didn't return phone calls. The same thing he did when he was a councilman in the 6th. And there's so many more examples. Here's what I'm nervous about right now. Last Sunday, I met with one of the business owners in the district that I represent, and he has been feeling bullied by the St. Louis County Health Department. And there are things that he was telling me that concerned me, such as some of these individuals would stay 4 or 5 hours long and would find every single thing that's wrong. And when he got his lawyer, the business owner found out that everything they charged him with from the county perspective, like 60% of it was wrong. And then he would go to his friends who had the same kind of businesses, and they had none of these violations. So I am concerned that the corruption that surrounded Steve Stanger went all the way down to the department level. And it concerns me. There are a lot of people who I remain close to from the Dooley administration who kept watching some of the things that were going on. Obviously, you recall when I was at county council talking about the, I think, 15 or 20 town hall meetings I was about to have for radioactive waste awareness, Coldwater Creek, and the Bridgeton landfill. Steve Stanger wouldn't even let me talk for my 3 minutes. He was just very, very disruptive. And the one thing that's important to note, in the first 6 weeks of his administration, Steve Stanger fired 10 African-American women, including Dolores Gunn, who was the head of the Department of Health, who did an amazing job, as well as former State Senator Rita Days.
So let's go a little bit forward-looking, you know. I was at the county council meeting where Sam Page was selected and also the county council meeting afterward. And before I make this observation, I must note that everybody who may have complained about the process usually said, "Congratulations, County Executive Page. I'm glad you're there. I hope you succeed." This was very respectful criticism. But I think that especially African-American municipal leaders, number one, they wanted Hazel Irby to be county executive. And number two, they didn't like the fact it was done the same day that Stanger resigned. I want you to kind of address those concerns. It's obviously kind of a moot point because Sam Page is county executive and he probably would have been county executive regardless. But that is the process has been criticized. What's your thought on that?
Well, here's what I will say. From the very beginning, I wanted someone from the current county council, whether it be Hazel or Sam or Lisa Clancy, who is my representative on county council. It didn't matter to me. I just wanted them to be on that board already because they have the wherewithal and just the everyday practice office of being in county government. With that said, in the last couple of years, from my understanding, Hazel did forfeit her seniority as being the person who is going to take the lead on county council, and gave that to Sam. Mm-hmm. And as a person who doesn't go to county council meetings frequently because I'm in Jefferson City, I don't know the goings on. What I do care about is service delivery for the people of St. Louis County. I care about people being smart enough to have policies that impact the most vulnerable people in St. Louis County, not St. Louis City. So, like, one of the concerns, which has nothing to do with what happened on Tuesday or Monday, but I wouldn't give $6 million to the Dome, and we have Castle Point, and we have Kinloch looking the way that it did, does right now. I would wait a week and work with my Republican allies like Ernie Trakas. But with all of that said, you know, I think that Hazel would have done a fine job, and I certainly think that Sam will do a fine job. I know that many people want to see another African American. There are two things that went on in this, just to let you know. One, there are a lot of people who were elated that Steve Stenger was gone. Mm-hmm. I think that's the most important thing that should be stated. Mm-hmm. People who are in politics, people who are out of politics, people who are activists in the community, they were just, it was almost as if, I put it on my Twitter, it was almost as if it were the third term of President Obama. That's how happy African Americans were in St. Louis County, number one. Now, number two is, would it be nice to have a female? Yes. Would it be awesome to have a black female? Absolutely. My constituent, who is one of my favorites, Tom Sullivan, he is the one who raised the issue of there not being time for the public to raise their concerns about the immediacy of the council meeting on Monday. And I think that is a lesson learned. I do think that we were in a situation as St. Louis County residents, we were in a situation where we needed to do an immediate response to the resignation and indictment of Steve Stenger.
Even though I think there were some raw feelings on Monday, I don't really expect a rift between Sam Page and Hazel Irby. They've been very close for a long time.
They have, and they're both good people. Yeah. Hazel really cares about her community and her district as well as Sam. And I don't want there to be any kind of ill feeling between the two of them or with any other person on the council, because we are there for St. Louis County residents, and that's what our work is for. It's not for the city, it's for St. Louis County.
Mm-hmm. Well, let's talk about County Executive Page's impact on the merger debate, and then we'll talk a little bit more about the Better Together plan. What impact do you think it has that Sam Page is in place instead of Steve Stenger when we're having this discussion about the Better Together merger plan?
I think we're going to have fair conversation. If he even looks at his history as a county executive and look at the example of Gene McNairy in 1988 and 1999 in our last Board of Freeholders, we had 18 or 19 members of the Board of Freeholders, and it was a thorough work between people of all different backgrounds. You had people from the labor movement, you had activists, African-American lawyers, you had women. I mean, it was wonderful. People were really considerate about the differences between rich municipalities and poor municipalities. People were concerned about the services. People were concerned about the amount of property taxes and what to do when it came to overtaxation. I mean, it was really a thoughtful process, which I have studied for the last 10 years now.
Yes.
And that's why I'm saying what I'm saying. I'm a Democrat, but what happened under that administration during Gene McNary.
Because Gene McNary was a Republican county executive. Yeah,
but it's a compliment to the work that is deserved and the work that should be done when it comes to such a big decision that impacts everyday people.
Now, you kind of have a, I don't want to say unusual stance within this merger debate, because you're not the only person who feels this way, but you are not anti-merger. In fact, you have actually submitted legislation for many years.
For about 9 or 10 years.
To basically have the city rejoin the county as a municipality. But you're not a fan of the Better Together plan. And the reason why I'm not saying you're the only person who believes this is I've run into a lot of different politicians who are kind of in this space. Your seatmate, State Representative Peter Meredith, for example, I think is philosophically in favor of merger, but he is not for this Better Together plan. And the fact that you're not on board to me is a bit telling. And
yeah.
That's my observation. I want you to kind of bounce off that observation I talked about and before we go to the next question.
The difference is I've done my research for years, and it started off with my consideration to run for state senate. And at the time, there were 41 municipalities that were in that state senate seat, and I was talking to a former senator, and I said, just how does this happen? How do you have all of these municipalities? And he suggested that I look up the previous Board of Freeholders. That was in 2009. So I did my due diligence, and I researched. I showed you my binder that's 10 years old.
It's a very big binder, folks. We obviously can't see it because this is a podcast, but it has to be like 300 pages long at least or something. But
yes, and I wanted to catalog everything and just read what the thoughts were from the different groups of people. As I said, you had some amazing, Claude Brown was on that. You had Margaret Wilson Bush.
Mm-hmm.
She was on that. You had a lot of voices from the outside, including the NAACP, who were concerned. The case, it ended up going to the Supreme Court based on old constitutional language that we had, but it was an agreed-to idea that we should reduce the number of municipalities that we had in St. Louis County. And people worked really, really, really diligently on this plan for 2 years in 1988 and 1989. All the documentation, if anyone's interested, is at UMSL, and there's over 1,000 hours of audio if you ever want to just go through it. I have in a brief manner at UMSL, but my own library has a lot of that information in University City, and our wonderful librarians helped me out to make sure I knew what I was talking about. But the reason why I'm against this is because it takes out the Board of Freeholders, which is the arm that's put in our state's our statutes so that we can have a fair conversation, and every single taxpayer, every single person who lives in St. Louis City or St. Louis County can have input in the process. And what Better Together is doing is absolutely wrong. I know that they're having these town hall meetings, and I know at some point they're going to claim that they've had 100 town hall meetings. I've done the same thing. So, but that doesn't matter. You have to be telling people the truth. How does this financially impact the most vulnerable person in St. Louis County or city?
Do you have an issue with the fact that this is going to statewide voters as opposed to local residents? And the reason I ask this question, I look at some of the constitutional amendments you proposed about the city joining as a muni. I don't see anything in those about a local vote in there. So I want to get your perspective, because that seems to be stoking a lot of opposition to this.
Yeah, if you go back again to the previous Board of Freeholders, it would only be St. Louis City and St. Louis County voters who would be making a determination for their future. Yesterday, I had the honor and privilege to stand up on behalf of SJR 54. I think that's Representative Plocker's bill.
It is.
While he's a Republican, he understands the strength that we need at the local level and how devastating it would be to have a statewide vote dictating what happens to the St. Louis region. And it was even more so wonderful that rural legislators stood up yesterday on the House floor and spoke in favor of Plocker's bill as well.
It was 143-10. I was surprised by the margin. Do you think it's going to face a tougher path in the Senate? There's kind of some feelings based on how Senator Walsh's non-binding resolution was received by people like Senator Bill Eigel, Senator Ed Emery, that they could potentially filibuster that and prevent it from getting to the 2020 ballot. What have you heard about that?
Well, here's what you also need to understand is in St. Charles, they just voted, the county council or whatever, they just voted against a statewide vote on the merger. They don't think that there should be a merger. And so those are the constituents of Senator Eigel. So he's going to have to look at that. He doesn't want, I'm pretty sure, with the increase in migration of people into St. Charles, he wouldn't want someone to say, let's merge St. Charles with St. Louis County. So he would want to have that independence. And so that's what people are thinking now. They don't want some outsider to come in and dictate what happens to their area. Now, if he believes in a merger, do it the right way. Agree with me. You know, sit down with me, someone who knows the history of a merger and the Board of Freeholders and how the process is absolutely democratic and includes all kinds of people. But just to stand up and filibuster something and not understand the issue and not have the depth of the issue, that would just be grossly wrong to the people of St. Louis.
I want to talk about the financial aspects of this merger, because we have talked a lot, both online and offline, that this is one of your biggest concerns. And when I say financial details, I mean how you're going to make the financials of a city-county merger work during the transition. One of the things that I ran across and that I called you for comment on was this Better Together report about cost savings and savings to the state. And the question I asked Kyle Juvers of Better Together was why they didn't get a third-party group to look at the potential numbers of that. This is what he had to say.
All the baseline numbers are publicly available information. And we've made these spreadsheets available on bettertogetherstl.com for years, as well as the comprehensive annual financial reports that we obtained them from. And each line item gets notated to the source document and page number in which we realized it from. And so if you're starting from a baseline of information that is publicly available, and what we have done is put forward the assumptions that we've made, it doesn't take a third party to realize what these numbers are.
What's your response to that?
Hogwash, and he's cheating the public. And let me tell you why he's not answering the question. The question that people want to know is, how is this going to hurt my bottom line? Of course it needs to be public. Anything financial needs to be public. That's what they did in the 1988 and 89 Board of Freeholders. The answer that he should be providing is, what are the overall costs? What are the overall taxes going to be? Are our property rates going to go down? Are we going to have an earnings tax? Are we going to have duplication of services? How are we going to do? Let me just tell you, as someone who has been a student of the previous Board of Freeholders, the issue of financial success or just the issue of finances was very, very critical to that board of freeholders. And they weighed very heavily the areas that were more financially sound and areas that were not. They weighed the areas that didn't have enough services and the areas that did. They even weighed the racial makeup of areas. And people really need to go back and read the Board of Freeholders and all that documentation, because you would know that statement that you heard is manure. I'm being nice, but that's a manure statement. And they had a third party, which is the information that I gave you.
Mm-hmm. Wasn't it PricewaterhouseCoopers,
yes,
if I'm not mistaken?
They did an independent fiscal analysis from top to bottom of what it would cost just to do a municipal merger in St. Louis County. And even what they don't mention, even the logistics of getting to that point have a price tag. And he doesn't mention that. So in that comment that I heard was a slap in the face to every single taxpayer in St. Louis because he's playing you like you're stupid. And that's the kind of talk that we hear in Jefferson City all the time where we just have to smack down and just get to the nitty gritty.
Before we move on to at least a couple of issues you're dealing with in the legislature, you know, if you talk with people besides Kyle Juvers and people who are supportive of the Better Together plan, they're going to say the way the region is structured now doesn't make any sense. Having all these cities and police departments and municipal courts doesn't make any sense. And even if this is not the perfect plan, something needs to be done because what is happening in St. Louis isn't working. How would you respond to argumentation like that? Because I'm almost positive that's going to be the messaging that is going to be sent to Missouri voters if Better Together gets enough signatures.
Well, that's obvious, but it doesn't mean that you scribble on a piece of paper and then that becomes your initiative petition. That's what they did. They scribbled on a piece of paper, not thinking about what democracy is supposed to look like. And as I said before, this is what, and I've thought about this for years, and I don't take it lightly at all. I mean, you have to understand, you know, the very difficult concepts that I've had to weigh over the course of my service, the transfer program, dealing with radioactive waste in multiple places in St. Louis. None of these issues has ever been easy to deal with. This is something that's very complex. It is learning Mandarin, German, and whatever else, all at the same time at 90 years old. It is very complex. It's very detailed. And over the course of years, as I've thought about it, because I really do want a merger, because I do believe that we are spending too much overhead. And that's one of the reasons, as a state senator, I encourage the municipalities to work together to reduce their overall costs. We literally had meetings as a Senate district to show how we are reducing costs so that measures like Better Together don't come in and just say that we're wasting tax dollars and people are working really hard. And I know that they are, but I've got to tell you, you can't, and I don't know just how to articulate it, Jason. I apologize.
That's okay.
But the issue is so complex. I mean, you basically have to take a layer at a time, and then you have to adjust for any caveats that may happen. The first thing that needs to happen, not the first necessarily, but what's most important is a correct fiscal analysis weighed in with the differences on income and race in every single part of St. Louis County and St. Louis City, and then make an adjustment for that. The most important thing that we have to be accountable for as a county and city of St. Louis are the services that we provide to our citizenry. If we stop our services at some point, they're not going to pay for no more taxes. Why should they if they're not getting services? Once you get to that point where you're being overly taxed, you're not going to support your government anymore. And I've seen that happen time and time again through the years. So this is a very complex idea. Can it happen? Absolutely. But it has to be very, very, very thoughtful. It's a slow process, and you have to incorporate every single kind of person and their interests and listen to them. What they did back in the day financially in the late 80s is they rolled back property tax. Do you know how many taxpayers would be impacted, property owners who would be impacted if you didn't make an adjustment for property taxes? Can you imagine, you know, how many people would be upset? On top of that, you would have an earnings tax. So there are adjustments that you have to make mathematically to even have a buy-in. You can't just outwardly say, well, what we're doing right now is not sustainable. You have to prove to people this is what the idea is going to look like in the future. This is how it's going to function, and have give a couple of examples. Is it going to be your refuse bill that's going to go down? Show people how they're going to be better off.
We'll be back after this message with State Representative and former State Senator Maria Chappelle-Nadal.
The Gateway brings you the day's news each weekday from around the St. Louis region and the state capitals in Jefferson City.
Our schools are accredited. We don't need this bill.
And Springfield.
How many more years must pass before lawmakers see time is of the essence?
I'm Abby Larico. Join me each weekday for The Gateway on the STLPR app or wherever you get podcasts.
And we're back with current state representative and former state senator Maria Chappelle-Nadal. Let's talk about quote-unquote clean Missouri and specifically the state legislative redistricting part. I've spent a lot of time talking with you about this last year when clean Missouri was being marketed and it eventually passed. I just recently had a piece about the impact on minority representation based off its language. There was a constitutional amendment sponsored by Representative Dean Plocker that passed last week. Were you the only Democrat that voted for it?
Yes, I was.
Were you surprised that there are definitely African-American legislators that may not have supported what Representative Plocker are doing, but they do not like clean Missouri? So were you surprised that not more of them joined you in voting yes for the amendment?
Well, what we have to understand is I'm very proud of those who voted present. You know, oftentimes there are people who aren't willing to go against their party. I am one of those people. I vote black first at this point. When I started years ago, 15 years ago, it was easy to be pro-choice. It was easy to be against the death penalty. It was easy to be for public education. But sometimes you get into these areas where you've got to follow your conscience. And to me, I care about future representation, especially after Ferguson, especially with these ideas of merging, that we have African-American representation. And I'm not the only one. I'm not the first one. I showed you a book earlier when we came in that Senior Clay, Bill Clay, wrote. And on page 200, he was talking about the redistricting of 1971 and 1972, where it was indeed the Democratic Party that was trying to weaken minority districts. And so in my own, and that was in 1971 and 72. And I'm just telling you, in the 19 years that I've been in the state capitol, black Democrats have had to work with Republicans on redistricting. And the greatest example I'll tell you is the Democrat that drew the district that I represented during redistricting all the way from North County to Kirkwood. Now, I don't have any similarities, even though they're good people in Kirkwood. I know the old Meacham Park my grandma comes from. But they drew the district so that a minority couldn't win. Just imagine, a minority wouldn't be able to represent Ferguson.
And I did allude to that in the article. That was not the only example. I believe that the 13th senatorial district was drawn to Chesterfield. It is currently represented by a white legislator, but I think it's kind of assumed that after 2020, an African American is going to represent it, although...
Yes, that's how we did it. And I'm just going to tell you the truth.
Yeah.
I'm going to let everybody know. Senators from St. Louis County were all in one room.
Yes.
Right in Clayton. It was including Schmidt. It was myself. It was
Lemke.
It was a whole bunch of us.
Yeah, and this was actually reported at the time, but people may not remember it, so continue.
This is the dirty truth that I said that I wouldn't talk about on the House floor because I wanted to protect my caucus.
Sure.
And let them know why I was voting the way that I was. Well, let me just tell you, from those conversations, they actually lost a seat. They lost Lemke. They lost Jane Cunningham. And that's what they gave up. To make sure they, as Republicans, gave up so that we can have minority districts. Yes. So the district that Gina Walsh represents possibly can be a minority. We can have 5 African Americans, maybe 6, if we continue to look at minority representation. And I'm telling you, with everything that I've gone through, and I apologize for people who have not lived with me for 19 years or going through through two redistricting bouts. But I am telling you that I want to ensure what previous legislators who were African American wanted to ensure, and that is minority representation. And I'm not going to give that up for nothing.
So Clean Missouri proponents will argue that the language in Clean Missouri will protect minority representation, and that it's prioritized over the competitiveness and partisan fairness standards. This is a clip from Yuri Rudensky, who's from the Brennan Center for Justice. That's a group that's strongly in favor of Clean Missouri and opposed to efforts to undo it. And he was talking about the idea of the language encouraging what he calls coalition districts, which he describes as such.
If white folks support white Democrats and if black folks support black Democrats, you wouldn't see any reduction in the percentages. But if what the results show is there are significant numbers of white people who are willing to vote for these black preferred candidates, then that's the only situation where that percentage could be taken down a bit.
So I was thinking about this because I definitely think that happens in Kansas City.
That happened to my district when I first ran.
Yeah, and I think that there are some parts of your current state rep district where you could argue that, you know, University City, for example, isn't it like a majority black city or slightly?
Well, let me tell you.
Yeah.
No.
Yeah.
So here's how it was, not this current one, but when I first ran for state rep, it was Albert Walton who drew it. Mm-hmm. And he made the argument that he drew it 60% African-American. However, it was 60% of the people who actually voted that were white.
Mm-hmm.
So 60, that's actually how I won, is because the way that that district was drawn, it was 60% white that actually came out and 40% black. And I knew we had that marriage ban on the ballot then, and I knew where I had to spend my time. And so we had a lot of things, but I was also crossover then. That was pre-Ferguson, so I was crossover. That's pre-transfer. But not many people can do that.
Yeah, that was going to be my question, because I think one of the questions that I asked some of the Clean Missouri proponents is, if you look at the St. Louis area, with some exceptions, if it's an African-American majority district, they elect African-Americans on a state and local level. If it's a white majority district, with the exception of Shamed Dogan and Carla May, they typically elect white legislators. And my point is, we still live in a very racially polarized electorate in the St. Louis area, and I'm not sure if coalition districts are happening yet, but based on what he said, wouldn't that prevent the percentages from going down if that's the way judges interpreted the language in Clean Missouri?
See, I look at Clean Missouri and I look at the Supreme Court, and I think we had this conversation some time ago, and I honestly believe if Clean Missouri ever made it to the Supreme Court, the Supreme Court wouldn't support it.
So when you're talking about Clean Missouri making it to the Supreme Court, like a map that comes out of the Clean Missouri process, continue.
Yes. Because we still do care about minority districts. You know, I know that some of the language from the 60s and 70s has changed a bit, but there is an interest in having minority districts because we're still a protected class of people. Mm-hmm. And not being able to have someone who looks like you and someone who thinks like you and understands your issues is a huge, huge problem. As I said on the House floor last week, you know, I'm lucky enough that there are Caucasian people in University City who want to have a black leader.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's some who don't. They're the same ones who voted for Steve Stenger. Those are the same ones who voted for Steve Stenger. But, you know, it's really complex. And I was able to win that seat. Rory Ellinger ended up having that seat. Sheila Lumpy had that seat. That's the state senate district that Harriet Woods had.
Mm-hmm.
And let me just tell you, I was thinking of, on my way here, I was thinking about the games that have been played in the future. And the first redistricting that I was around for, that's when they changed the 13th and the 14th district numbers.
Mm-hmm.
And John Bowman ran. Even though he didn't win, he ran. They switched the numbers so he could run. And that's what happened again, is they took the 7th district, which Jane Cunningham had represented, and sent that over to Kansas City, where Jason Holzman ran and won. So even when we sit down and we're looking at these Senate districts as Black Democrats with Republicans, they're giving up their own too. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it's when I kept looking at our own maps, and I promise you, if you go to that Bill Clay book on page 200 from 1971, at least since then, he'll talk about how white Democrats kept trying to draw Black people from not having Black representation for decades, and nothing's changed. Nothing has changed. Mm-hmm. I'm a Democrat. I'm loyal to the Democratic Party. I'm going to keep supporting Democrats, but I am Black before I'm a Democrat, and I want the next generation of people to be able to have someone that looks like them and thinks like them.
So I don't think there's any real suspense that something like Representative Plocker's amendment is going to make the 2020 ballot. Even if there's a filibuster in the Senate, I think the Republicans eventually use the previous question to quash the filibuster. The question I have for you is, how do you convince voters to vote for this when they've just put in this new state legislative redistricting system in place?
Well, here's what's interesting. This language impacts minority districts as much as it does districts like Senator John Rizzo. And he represents a rural area, and he cares about this. What your listeners may not know is, in places like Berkeley and Rachel Prouty's district, 50% of her district voted against Clean Missouri. And most people didn't know about this. We were at our plant sale last weekend in University City, and we were talking about this issue. And one of my white constituents asked about my position on this issue. And in total surprise to me, she responded to me by saying that I prefer to have a minority as my representative. And I said that on the House floor last week. And I was shocked because I didn't, you know, we have a lot of advocates. You know, we have a lot of Caucasian people with Black Lives Matter. But, you know, how many of those people actually practice empowerment of people of color? And I'm lucky to live in a district where there are many Caucasians that do, and there are many that don't. But this individual understood. And when I say that it's important to have the African American voice in the legislature, I mean it, because there are bills that come up. And if you didn't have an African American who understood the culture, who understood the nuance in certain bills, there wouldn't be anyone to stand up and say, wait a minute now, we've got to stop and look back at this legislation. This is how it impacts my community. If you're white, you may not understand that caveat. You may not understand that intricacy and what it means to people. And that's why I'm fighting so hard for this. And I truly believe, I do have to say that if I didn't have all the years behind me, that I probably would have voted present as well. But I've been in the Capitol for 19 years now. I've been through 2 redistricting times, and I've seen what I've seen. I know what I know, and that's why I voted the way I did.
Thank you, Senator, for coming on the show, and I really appreciate your time, and congratulations on joining the illustrious 5-timers club. For all of our stories, stlpublicradio.org. Follow me on Twitter, Jay Rosenbaum. How can people follow you on Twitter or any other parts of the World Wide Web?
On Twitter, at Maria, Chapelle. In.
Thank you very much. Until next time, so long.
Smash, smash, crack, push, whack, tie another one to the racks, baby. Hey, rock and roll. Nobody tells you where.